Arsenal-Manchester United always had an edge to it.
When you get to competitive individuals like Sir Alex Ferguson and Arsene Wenger, there's always going to be a fuse.
I don't think they have a chance against us. I don't think they have a chance.
But that's a rivalry. Managers push each other, players push each other.
They didn't see eye to eye, and they really hated each other.
It felt like you was going to war.
I didn't like any of their players.
You had to have somebody to complain about. Arsenal. Wenger.
Desire was always a big thing for Alex Ferguson. You know, when you'd won a league, when you'd won two leagues, and if you felt you came back the next season not hungry and ready to go again and have that desire and fire in your belly to start all over again, you were gone.
Give him an eye go!
The manager was there every day. I can't remember how many days I didn't see him at the training ground.
Was more than going seeing your headmaster. It was more than being told that it was you was in the presence of someone that was intense, that was driven, and it was scary, to be honest with them.
You know what he's like? You're trying to grow, you give it a big time, Charlie, but you get fucking wired right into him. He's fucking full of shit, you know that. I mean, he's going on the paper wanting respect for your fans and that. He'll fucking get it, all right. Plenty of that.
I've never actually spoken a word to him. Spent 22 years as a pro and 15 years at Arsenal. He shouted a few things at me, and I'm sure I've shouted a few things back, but I was scared of him.
Some of the passing is fucking scratchy. Get the passing fluid. Take a touch in the ball.
I think he was Jekyll and Hyde, Sir Alex, at times. I mean, yes, he could be confrontational. He could be somewhat belligerent if he didn't like the question, or he didn't suffer fools gladly, I can assure you of that. Now, I had one famous row with him on Match of the Day when I asked him about Roy Keane's disciplinary record.
Is the Roy Keane situation one that you'll have to address?
Right, John, you've no right to ask that question. You're out of order. You know fine well my ruling in that, right? That's the interview finished. I'm ruling that one. I want to cancel that interview, right? The whole fucking lot of it. Cancel it.
What I was asked to ask you, Alec.
You're fucking logging in again, right? You fucking know the rules here.
And he stormed off. And then didn't do an interview with me for quite some time. Although, having said all of that, underneath it all, there is a very charming and intelligent man.
I always found one of the things about Ferguson is that he used emotion very intelligently. He went through the gears. I mean, I ended up just going to Ferguson's press conference when Manchester United lost, because that was Ferguson at his best. He would come out and he would blame the referee, he would blame the media, he would blame, you know, the temperature of the tea at half-time, anything to defend his players.
Straightforward, the players don't like the grey strip.
This image of Ferguson, partly because of his dugout stance, partly because of the whole hairdryer reputation, actually ignores what an intelligent, nuanced individual he is. If you went into his office, it was just a treasure trove of a man's life and a man's interest. So on the table, there would be a catalogue of art. And there were a couple of cases of very nice wine, pictures on the wall, and his fascination with Laurel and Hardy. If you want a Renaissance man, it's Sir Alex Ferguson. Certainly one of the most interesting people I've met in public life, and one of the most extraordinary leaders this country's ever seen.
He had the Giggs and the Cantonars and the Steve Bruces and the Brian Robsons. the Scholes and the Keens, and suddenly you saw a team developing that was going to rule English football, or thought they were, for several years.
My best decade. Good luck, son.
The players were winners, snarling winners, who weren't going to allow anybody else to try to interfere with that.
Right now, get yourself sorted, OK? Come on.
No goals! No goals!
No easing up. Come on now. Listen, don't let yourselves down here now. Don't even fucking attempt it.
Thank you very much.
Wenger was initially hardly known in this country. And of course, he'd been managing in Japan at Grampus 8. So nobody over here really knew much about this guy, and yet here he was, being brought in by Arsenal, and ultimately, and not that far ahead, to challenge Alec Ferguson.
There was real curiosity about him, a lot of scepticism about him.
He had a grin on his face the whole time. In fact, I was worried that maybe nice guys don't win things.
Arsene Wenger's been in Japan for a year. He doesn't know anything about English football. He's at a, well, the use of a big club, Arsenal. I think he should concentrate on his own job.
Whenever Sir Alex used to start mentioning opposition managers, opposition teams, you knew that they were becoming a threat, and you knew it was the start of that psychological battle.
It was fun from a media perspective because you realised that the rivalry was going to kick off pretty spectacularly.
I had the good fortune to meet him in 1989 when he came to the old Highbury Stadium. He was just passing through and he was watching a game. And I said, how long are you here for? And he said, well, just overnight. And I said, well, what are you doing tonight? He said, nothing. I said, would you like to join my wife and I? We're going to dinner. Would you like to come with us? And his answer changed all our lives. It was something in the stars I saw. Arsene for Arsenal. It's destiny. It's going to happen one day. I mean, he did revolutionise the club dramatically. I mean, in those days, everybody had a drinking culture. It was quite common knowledge. But he changed the whole dietary methods. He changed the training methods. He made sure that the boys looked after their bodies so much better.
He came in with all these new ideas about the way that we were going to train, the way we were going to stretch, massages, and then the food. It changed everything about the diet. You know, you've got to hold your hands up and say, yep, Arsene Wenger definitely added a 2 or 3 years at least on some of the players that were there.
You looked at some of those players and Wenger was making them fitter. You know, he got them putting creatine on their cornflakes at training to sort of boost their powers of recovery.
A club like Arsenal, no one could quite believe it was happening to English football and the most English of football clubs.
I remember saying to him how disappointed I was that he had come in as manager, because under the previous manager, Bruce Rioch, I captained the team for the last 20-odd games of the season in the absence of Tony Adams, and he reassured me, do exactly what you've done last year. And by the way, go and see David Dean and sort out a pay rise.
Well done, Gillian Ducard. Yes, well done.
He influenced dramatically, not just Arsenal, the rest of English football.
And never forget going away with England. All of a sudden, there was this change of attitude from the Arsenal players. The food that they ate, the nutrition. You take note and you go back to your club thinking, they're doing something a little bit different here.
We were a successful team, And what he also did was he made sure that we were a physical team.
Arsene Wenger's got plenty to say. We should maybe concentrate on what Ian Wright's tackles, maybe, rather than talk about Manchester United.
From the point of view of Sir Alex Ferguson, it's easy to see why it would be something that would pique his nerve, that somebody comes in and is being acclaimed for being some sort of exotic genius who might be saying, is he reinventing the wheel?
Obviously there were things that were done very, very differently, and he was a departure from the traditional gaffer of kind of football folklore who spoke the language of the shop floor.
Hello. Pam Martin. Well, well, well.
If you go into Arsenal's training ground when we were allowed upstairs, he was absolutely horrified by this English habit of pouring milk in your tea. It was like you'd sort of thrown paint on the Mona Lisa. It was just a scandal. Someone was putting some sugar in as well, and he was horrified about that as well. But he said, it is all in the detail. If you want to do this horrible habit of putting sugar in, this is how you do it. And he took a small teaspoon, and he put a lump of sugar in it, and he held it just below the surface, and he moved it side to side so that it absorbs fully throughout the tea. Marginal gains. This is a man king on detail.
Of course, the other thing that helped Arsene Wenger have instant, more or less, success was just the golden touch for his early signings.
He had access to a market of players that, and a knowledge of it that no other manager, not even Alex Ferguson, had, and that was the French market.
I was playing with the academy in Monaco. He gave me my first opportunity to play with the first team. But more important, he was behind me like a father. I lost my brother 2 years before that, or maybe a year before that, and I was living a tragedy, you know, inside. I remember every time I came at a training camp in the morning, I was listening music with my earphones all the time. I was in my own world all the time. Arsene, I remember, he came to see me at a training camp and he said, I don't want you to change. The only thing I want you to change is life can be beautiful. We are not here just to play football. We are here to build human being as well. So if you're happy, then you're going to become a better person, and then you're going to become a better player on the pitch.
He signed fabulous footballers, Patrick Vieira, Thierry Henry, Emmanuel Petit, you know, footballers who made us, Nicolas Anelka, who made us think differently about what was possible from a player in that position.
French flair, technique, movement, the ball on the ground, you know, because back in the day, Arsenal were Brent, 1-0 boring Arsenal, the ball in the air all the time, kick and rush. And all of a sudden, with the lack of Patrick, myself, the French guys, you know, you couldn't play, you know, the ball in the air.
I think Ferguson would have looked at Arsenal, looked at the type of players that Wenger was bringing in, the sort of strength and the athleticism, and realised, wow, this is a huge test.
All the qualities that had made us such a great team, they had those in abundance, and they played fantastic football, and the whole country were probably on their side.
The moment that the rival really took a clear step up was at Old Trafford in the 97-98 season, when Marc Overmars scored the winning goal in what felt very pivotal.
Overmars, maybe this time, yes!
Wenger won the double in 1998, his first full season at Arsenal, And my goodness me, what a good team he had. And they deserved that championship victory. And Ferguson admitted that begrudgingly, I think, at the time.
And you could just imagine Ferguson up at Old Trafford just seeing that this new individual and thinking it was almost, look, he's plotting to take my throne.
People sometimes ask me, well, what made you choose Arsene Wenger? And I always say, well, in his first full season, winning the double, I think that was a pretty good clue.
David, are you still in the office? I'm just leaving, I'm going home now. Okay, so I see you later. Sorry?
You could see his mind thinking that what we were thinking, these are better than us, and that we need to improve.
And Arsenal won the double. You don't want to see your competitors win the double, so it's not a case of stepping your game. I think we're bitterly disappointed that we're not the team in that position to be doing that.
You can see him planning, how do I topple these? Because this is going to be probably my biggest battle ever as a Manchester United manager.
If he tries to bill you, fucking enjoy it. Don't fucking even let him attempt to fucking bill you. I don't care you do it verbally or physically, you just fucking make sure you're ready for him.
It's funny, in team talks against Arsenal, the ball was very rarely mentioned, really.
It's fucking big time, Charlie, but it's against fucking men, am I right?
We knew we had to get about them, we had to tackle them. The manager always put that into us, he revved us up.
And it was chipping away at us every day, with little things. It wasn't just a big Winston Churchill speech, it was every single day. Everyone loves Arsenal. Look at the football that they're playing, lads. Everyone's praising them. And it was hurting us every single day.
We get the ball transferred into these areas here. I don't think they've a chance against us. I don't think they've a chance.
The gaffer, he loved the challenge. He had to have someone to fight. He had to have somebody to complain about. Arsenal. 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 Wenger. The first 5-6 months, I don't think I slept one night. I think I was up till 2 or 3 in the morning, making sure every session that I did, making sure the next day that it was near perfect. We'd fly home from Europe, land at 3 or 4 in the morning, and I'd say, I could do with a day off, or we could do with training later. When Roy Keane said no. We're in normal time, 10:30 to start training. We're in the boxes on the field at 10:30. I said, yeah, but we don't. We're in at 10:30 every day, no day off. Working there for nearly 3 years just brought home to me and taught me what it takes to be number one.
I do remember this semi-final, you know, two forces coming together, we'd won the double, they were to go on and win the treble.
My biggest memory of the night was the team sheet coming in and Ryan Giggs was on the bench. All I kept thinking was, we're 70, 80 minutes in when I'm really tired, Giggs is going to come on then. So all the lads were high-fiving because Giggs wasn't playing and I was the only one who was sitting in the toilet reading the programme going, I'm in trouble here.
I never forget, on the bus journey to the game, the bus was silent, and it's never silent. I get goosebumps now thinking about it. It felt like he was going to war.
Beckham! What a goal!
The best game of football I've ever played in. All of the Man United players say the same.
Because there was so much at stake and we were so close to him in the league, it felt like whoever won this would win the league.
Roy got sent off, down to 10 men, and odds are against us, really.
Stoppage time down.
I give away a penalty in the last minute. The biggest mistake I've ever made. I thought my Man United career was over.
I didn't have a good feeling. I felt maybe Dennis would miss. I know that's bizarre.
It's one of them moments that you get in football. You look up to the gods and you say, our season depends on this penalty. This is it.
It was going to penalties, it was extra time, and then Patrick hit that absolutely rubbish pass to me across the pitch.
One of them moments that will live forever in football history.
I have to make a tackle before he reaches the box. I didn't expect him to go past two or three other players after that.
And then went on that ridiculous sort of celebration.
All I remember is his hairy chest coming towards me.
That's when you need your big players to step up and, you know, what a goal to win a game.
It was massive, because if we didn't win that game, we'd never gone on to complete the treble. So it was huge.
Still one of the hardest things I've ever done in football. After that game, me and Tony Adams shook everyone's hand in the dressing room and wished them all the best in the final. But I was still miserable, and I still, if Gary Neville had not shook my hand, I probably would have knocked him out in the dressing room. But because I, you know, I didn't like any of their players, because it was United.
I think we needed to sort of toughen up. Sir Alex Ferguson, I felt, had a great influence on the referee at the halftime of that match. Let's just say he was very, very aggressive. The referee looked petrified. And thereafter, I vowed that I would get between Sir Alex Ferguson and the referee, or whenever I needed to be, I would play an extra role.
The first time I went to Old Trafford, he came in after the game and absolutely blistered me with the hairdryer going full blast, having a go at me over, would you believe, timekeeping.
He had a massive influence in English game, there's no doubt. We know we call it Fergie time now.
Fergie wasn't shy about trying to dominate a referee, and if that helped influence the referee, so be it. The first time I refereed Man United versus Arsenal at Old Trafford, I actually went out of my dressing room, turned left, and headed up to the Man United home dressing room. And he was waiting for me. And I said to him, "Hi, Alex Grandpole. I know who you are, son." So I said, "Well, you know what to expect today, don't you?" And he said, "Aye, nothing."
I'd say over my time in these games, I think we got the better decisions by the referees. And I think it was a big bugbear of the Arsenal players and Arsene Wenger, the way that probably referees tended to favour us. We were experienced, we knew how to play the referees, we knew the words to say to them, we knew the right time to put pressure on them, and it's something that they were learning, but we were probably the masters at it.
Win at all costs against anybody, but especially against Arsenal. We always felt you had one or two players who maybe a little bit soft.
That's a rivalry, so you push each other. Managers push each other, players push each other.
We had a psychologist that came in to talk to us about why we weren't winning things. And it was about reaching boiling point, but it was about staying below the line.
They were the two biggest teams during my 13 years refereeing Premier League games. And so I wanted to referee every time they played each other.
There wasn't really anybody else in the picture. That tells you that there's something stewing eyeball to eyeball, nose to nose.
And both sets of players at the time probably crossed lines that we shouldn't have done. Without a shadow of a doubt, it came from the managers.
They were just two great competitors who hated, hated losing.
And Keane has slipped home the winner, and Manchester United players and fans celebrate.
He wasn't a good loser. He wasn't a good loser at all.
For a second yellow card of Patrick Vieira is ridiculous.
If you don't feel pain when you're being conned, when are you going to feel pain? You know, it just shows passion, and you just want things done properly. But, you know, the world is not perfect.
We always felt that he wasn't gracious at the time. He never really gave us any credit. There was always that attitude that we're better than you.
Will Thomas score, surely, and does, and gives Arsenal the lead.
They came to our place and won the Premier League. Sir Alex Ferguson went in their dressing room, I think with a couple of bottles of champagne, and said congratulations to him. That, I think, is class. That even that's the last place in the world that he would have wanted to go.
Wenger was being asked about who had the best team at the time, and he made this little remark that everyone thinks they've got the prettiest wife at home. Fergie was furious about this. And people tried to explain to him, look, he doesn't mean it personally. He doesn't mean it about your wife. He really, really went for Wenger, called him a disgrace, called him an absolute embarrassment, and it spiralled out of control.
There was a perception, I think, from Arsenal's point of view, that that Man United didn't always necessarily play fair for them. And the boiling injustice they felt when they perceived that Ruud van Nistelrooy had got Patrick Vieira sent off.
It was a row that was brewing. And the word cheat and the word, you know, diver were regularly bounded about in press conferences. And then that late penalty, I think Arsenal felt cheated at that time.
It puts on the spot and you think, well, game over.
And then when the player missed, I just give it to him, as you might do in the playground.
I don't think a United player would have reacted the way he did. Keown went over the top, really. It wasn't a nice thing to see.
It was unfortunate. People have said I regretted it. I never said that.
It was probably the biggest disgrace of all time, the way that those Arsenal players acted.
The Nevilles like to label things and sensationalise, and I think it was more of a disgrace that there was no one there to protect Van Nistelrooy. They seemed to let us loose on him.
They acted like spoiled kids, and that summed our relationships up at that time. It had gone too far.
There's anger and there's relief. But it wasn't anger because we was going to break a row. It was anger because you conned the ref.
We got a little bit carried away. You could say we went below the line, but you know, you look back, it was a huge sporting moment because we went unbeaten. Who was to know that with that miss, if he puts that in the back of the net, then Arsenal couldn't have achieved something that Manchester United never did in that period when they were the team, and we somehow managed to pull that off, and they didn't.
It can't get better than this. This is the best day for Arsenal Football Club ever, and it ain't going to be repeated for some time. Go on, you got it!
That run that they went on, you have to admit it, as a former Manchester United player, that their football that they played was probably some of the best that the Premier League's ever seen.
I think everyone will remember that in the year 2003 and 2004, our team stayed unbeaten, and the team in question was Arsenal. Thank you.
And I used to say it before every game, you know, take a look, because you won't see a better group of players ever again. You know, you could have gone to war with that group.
And when you hear Wenger now talk about his greatest achievement, he talks about the 49 games unbeaten, and the fact that United were so desperate to stop it, I think says a lot about the mindset of Ferguson.
We'll get into the stage that, God, when are we going to lose? Can we just keep on going? It's incredible, isn't it? You know, God, they came back again.
It was all about Arsenal getting to 50 games, and we wanted to stop that. We were determined to do it.
We were ready. In a period of 12 months when they'd got the best of us, this was our moment. Sir Alex knew it was our moment. He placed every little bit of the last 2 weeks on this particular game. They're not coming to Old Trafford and they're not going to do us. They had a young Spanish winger called Juan Antonio Reyes, and we literally kicked him off the park. I think he got subbed off for about 60 minutes. Every time he got the ball, Gary smashed him. Next time he got the ball, I smashed him. Next time he got the ball, Scholes smashed him. And after a bit, I remember him looking at him thinking, what am I doing in English football?
Penalty given!
Now, at the time, we were pretty pissed off. It would be picked up now, that type of situation, and it wouldn't be a penalty.
It was ironic, really, that it was Rudy who stepped up to take the penalty and to win their run.
Arsenal felt cheated that day, and it was quickly apparent that something had gone off in the tunnel.
The Battle of the Buffet, I think, was in our headlines, or certainly in our mind, not quite realising exactly the nature of which elements of the buffet had been used as for artillery practice.
It's tight. I mean, Man United corridor is tight, but then you had 20 people. It's chaos.
Wenger, who obviously loathed Van Nistelrooy, was having a go at him. Ferguson, who is brilliant in those circumstances, defends his man.
There was all a bit of a commotion going on. And then right in front of my eyes, I saw a pizza wing its way, right, just flying in the air. And unfortunately, just landing on Sir Alex.
The boss is going round, like, saying, who threw that pizza? And straight away, somebody said, it's that little Spaniard, Fabregas.
I think it was a disgraceful way to lose. There was a lack of discipline at Arsenal, and this showed a complete lack of discipline, lack of respect towards the best manager that there's ever been, probably.
There was no fracas in the tunnel. I deny that categorically, and that is, you know, what with a bit of money today, you can get any story you want in a newspaper.
We all hate losing, but you have to show a modicum of respect, I suppose. And you always see him now, it's always the referee's fault, or he won't shake the other manager's hand.
In this occasion, I feel that Man United did not like play the game with the spirit we tried to play, and that the referee didn't, without interfering in any decision he made. I don't feel that he had enough authority on the game to make football we love respected.
Not just Arsenal, but his team was a little bit rattled. His team stopped playing football. His team thought, probably, well, we're playing against United, they beat us last year, they kicked us off the park, they've changed their style a little bit, we're going to go toe-to-toe and make it a fight against them. And it wasn't probably what they were about.
Night game has more intensity to it, I always feel. I walked past, it was the old Highbury ground, past the away dressing room on the right, and Fergie was standing outside. And he just said to me, and I just knew the game was going to be tough, he said to me, good luck. And you just think, oh no.
Vieira said something to Gary Neville in the warm-up, which was crazy, really. You know, a warm-up, who's thinking about, you know, saying something, even talk to another player.
It's amazing, a small thing can spark.
Gary came in the dressing room and told everyone. And I didn't know that Roy Keane was actually listening. You know, Roy getting his boots, having his drink and stuff. And Gary being Gary, saying, Vieira said this, Vieira said that to me, said he's going to do this to me, said he's going to do that to me. A real drama queen.
I just reminded Vieira, the last time we'd been together with Roy Keane, we made Roy, the previous season, we made Roy laugh in the tunnel before the game. And I said to him, see if we can do it again tonight. And he went, not tonight, Roy.
Roy felt that Patrick was trying to bully him. I don't think any of us could be bullied.
That's where we won the game.
He was aggressive, but he always got the best out of everyone around him. And now he's shown Patrick Vieira that day how to lead the football team.
Nothing more in here. You understand?
Relations had completely broken down and they just couldn't tolerate each other. Wenger actually went through a period where he actually refused to use Ferguson's name. I always remember being there in a press conference where he would say, I will never talk about that man again. He could not stand him.
The landscape changed overnight, so Abramovich bought Chelsea in the summer of 2003 and it happened very, very quickly. They could compete almost instantly.
Please don't call me arrogant, because what I'm saying is true. I'm European champion, so I'm not one of the bottle. I think I'm a special one.
It turned out that Ferguson and United were much more resilient in the face of the new challenge that the modern Premier League provided for them.
Arsenal had to change the politics of Arsenal when they started to change the stadium. They have to repay, you know, the loan from the Emirates Stadium. This changed the identity of Arsenal. They were playing such a good football, but without winning any trophies. And the fact Arsène and Arsenal used to sell their best player at the end of every single season on top of it.
He's Van Persie! Written in the stars!
I think the damage that brought into the team and into the team spirit was something that I think no one could imagine that at Arsenal.
I think that when Ferguson felt that Wenger wasn't a threat anymore, he just said, well, I can just be nice to him in public now because he's not a threat.
Ferguson had the great flourish, the great ending, this incredible finale with his family on the pitch and his players, and you know, the way that anyone would want to go in any walk of life, whether it was politics or business, this was the way that a great man steps off the stage.
You know how good you are. You know the jersey you're wearing. You know what it means to everyone here. And don't ever let yourself down.
No, he's enough. Come on, now. Listen, don't let yourself down here now. Don't even fucking attempt it.
He's the best manager I've ever played for. His understanding of me was phenomenal. I mean, I think he's the only person who understood me better than me.
So Alex Ferguson's time at Manchester United is one long success story. Arsene Wenger's is two stories in the same book. The second act has been a struggle.
I reckon Arsene Wenger is deliberately sabotaging the next 2 years so whoever takes over has such a fucking impossible job. He can sit there and go, well, I told you it ain't easy. Fucking hell, Robbie! When is it gonna end? Everyone within this club in a position of power.
You don't know how he's feeling because he really controls himself well. Well, he did. You know, when he was there, and when I watch him on the touchline, I'm like, that's not the Arsene Wenger I used to know.
I think I worked for 16 years here in England, and I deserve a bit more credit than wrong information. But I've only one intention is to harm.
I think he went away from bringing character into the team, bringing strength into the team, which, as he's proven over the years in England, it's needed. That's why they're probably not as good as they used to be and not challenging for what they should be.
I just wish we could have won more trophies under Arsene Wenger. But, you know, he did OK. He did OK.
He just extended his contract and he said, well, Arsene, but later on in life, what do you think you're going to do? He said, you know, it's difficult because football is my life. He said, you know, when I die and I go up to, hopefully I go up to heaven, the Almighty will say to me, well, what did you do during your life? And he said, well, I tried to win football matches. And the Almighty will say to me, is that all? And he'll say, it's not that easy, you know.
I do think that Fergie won the feud. I do think he reigned supreme. There were times when I think that Wenger, without doubt, gave him a bloody nose. But I think over that period of time, Fergie was the best manager in the Premier League era.
Both managers wanted to win, but I think Sir Alex had a bigger determination to win at all costs.
I think Arsene's legacy is different in as much as he took over a club that was reasonably successful, but then transformed the whole of English football. I believe he was the catalyst for all that is great in the game now.
You'll definitely never see those days again that you have a manager in one club for 10 years. Maybe five, but no 10. It doesn't happen anymore. Those days are gone.
What a brilliant time it was to just watch football and to watch two really brilliant leaders. I just think of that time and think how lucky we were to live it.
It's Britain's tallest and most iconic peak. Discover the beauty and danger of Ben Nevis, the venomous mountain, brand new tomorrow at 9. But tonight, from acid attacks to terror at the seaside, the Eye in the Sky spying criminals caught on camera, new and next.